Okay, so here's one of those spots where we really can't resist getting ahead of ourselves a bit to talk about something that's really important and apropos to our current discussions. We just found out that the pancreas is an important digestive organ because of its secretions of enzymes and bicarbonate ions, and we call this the pancreas's exocrine function. That's secretion outside of the body because, as you remember, the inside of your gut is actually outside your body. But many of you may be aware that the pancreas has another role as an endocrine organ, producing the hormone insulin and secreting this into your body, that is, into the bloodstream. You likely know that this is part of the system that goes awry in a person who has diabetes. But we'll start by talking about how the pancreas and the liver interact with the digestive system in a way that regulates blood sugar, that is, the level of glucose in the blood. Having some blood glucose at all times is absolutely essential because this is the main source of fuel that all of your cells use. Most of your body's cells could, however, if pressed, make enough ATP using other molecules for food, such as amino acids or fats. Your brain, however, is different. Glucose is the only form of fuel that's usable by your brain. If your blood sugar drops, you could go into a state of hypoglycemia that could involve an altered mental state, seizures, unconsciousness, and ultimately death. The opposite condition to hypoglycemia, hyperglycemia, which is having too much sugar in the blood, is not so immediately life-threatening on its own, though it can have serious long-term effects. Most importantly, it indicates a problem with the normal liver function that we talked about in the previous video, where the liver soaks up the excess sugars that are in the blood coming from the intestine and storing the sugar as glycogen. When this system works properly, a person's liver would basically never allow the blood sugar to climb too high. This same liver glycogen is also the source for adding glucose to the blood. And this is what keeps you from going hypoglycemic during those long periods between meals. This is what normally happens. So, what is insulin, and how is its production by the pancreas related to this normal mechanism of blood sugar homeostasis? Well, you should remember from a previous unit that human insulin is a protein that is now mass-produced in transgenic bacteria as a class A example of how bioengineering has had a positive contribution to human well-being. But you should also know that insulin is a hormone, that is, a chemical produced by specialized cells in the body, the pancreas in the case of insulin, and get carried through the body by the blood and acting on specific target cells elsewhere in the body, and insulin is one of these hormones. The pancreas produces insulin proportionately to blood sugar level. So when blood sugar increases sharply after a meal, so does insulin production. What insulin does is that it activates lots of cells throughout the body, causing them to increase their uptake of glucose. And in particular, the liver is stimulated to take up glucose, and it has the ability to take up lots and lots of the excess glucose, which, as we now know, gets stored as glycogen. And this is the key to reducing blood sugar back down to low levels. Later on, when the blood glucose levels are on the low side, that liver glycogen needs to be hydrolyzed so that glucose can be released into the blood. This is also mediated by a hormone produced by the pancreas, but it's not insulin this time. The raise blood glucose hormone is glucagon. And the pancreas secretes glucagon in response to low blood sugar. And then the glucagon goes over to the liver and it tells it to release some sugar into the blood. This combination of insulin and glucagon will, when operating properly, regulate your blood sugar to within a range of about 65 to 105 milligrams per deciliter. That's the unit that you'll typically hear blood sugar levels reported in. Glucagon doesn't allow it to drop below 65. And insulin doesn't allow blood sugar to remain above 105 for long periods of time. Diabetes mellitus is a condition in which blood sugar levels remain persistently elevated so that even after fasting, a person will test at greater than 127 milligrams per deciliter. In a rather typical manifestation of late onset or type 2 diabetes, this is usually caused by the liver cells becoming resistant or non-responsive to insulin. In other words, the blood sugar goes up, and the pancreas does produce the insulin, but the liver cells don't respond and they don't remove the excess of glucose. There may also be a reduced production of insulin by the pancreas, but the bottom line is that the blood sugar stays persistently elevated, chronic hyperglycemia, and this is generally bad for your physiology. It causes problems with excretion, taxing the kidneys to the point of kidney failure. It causes complications with the blood vessels, especially in the eyes, the heart, and the feet. And it causes complications with the nervous system. Type 2 diabetes is a chronic disease and one that affects millions of Americans. This disease's prevalence, that is, the percentage of people who are afflicted, has doubled in the period between 1990 and 2005, and this qualifies it as an epidemic, and one that's directly related to our country's very significant problem with obesity. More on this later.